Hi, I'm Corey. I'm a CPA and subject matter expert in financial accounting. And in this video, we're going to run through an overview of the long-term debt markets. Our first step will be to define the concept of long-term debt. Once we get an understanding of this piece, we'll spend some time discussing the key elements of the debt markets using specific examples, and we'll be keeping in mind the accounting implications that come with it. Understanding how long-term debt markets work is critical for a company's ability to grow and thrive. So let's get started. Have you ever been in a situation where you needed to access cash now that you knew you wouldn't be able to pay back until well into the future? Maybe this came in the shape of a student loan, or maybe even a mortgage investment in a home for your family. Companies run into these same types of situations where they also need to take on debt in order to invest in new resources and grow the business. However, the type of debt that the organization chooses to take on can impact its financial statements. Therefore, it's extremely important to get an understanding of how the long-term debt markets work. Before we get into the debt markets, I want to pose the following question. What is long-term debt? In accounting, when we refer to long-term debt, we're talking about a company's loans and other liabilities that won't come due until future years. To be more specific, it's any debt that's not due to be paid back within the next 12 months. Let's say it's currently January and a company needs a quick loan to purchase some inventory that they plan to pay back quickly. They borrow the money from the bank on January 1st and plan to pay it back by the end of the month. Since this loan comes due within the current year, it would not be considered long-term debt, but instead would be categorized as current debt. However, in the event they needed the loan for a longer period of time and it didn't come due until 2 years later, this is the type of loan that would be considered long-term debt. Why does this classification matter? Well, this will determine the category of liability that the debt will fall under on the company's balance sheet, which ultimately impacts decisions by users such as banks and investors. So now that we're clear on the concept of long-term debt, let's talk about the debt markets. Long-term debt markets are the platforms where these debt securities are traded. Think of these platforms as places like the stock exchange or foreign currency market. A modern economy needs these types of long-term debt markets because they facilitate the transfer of money from those who have it to those who need it. There's two kinds of markets: primary markets and secondary markets. Primary markets are places where equity shares and bonds are first issued to investors. A company that is looking for access to debt financing could sell its bonds in these capital markets. More on this to come later. Secondary markets are regulated environments where stocks and bonds are traded between investors after the fact, such as on the New York or London Stock Exchange. Now that we understand a little bit more about long-term debt and where it comes from, let's talk about a common accounting misconception. Since the value of long-term debt changes over time in the company's balance sheet, there tends to be confusion on how to account for it, and there's more than one way to do it. Both US GAAP and IFRS allow companies to account for this type of debt using one of two approaches. They have the choice to use either the amortized cost approach or the fair value approach. Amortized cost is based on the book value of the debt instrument. This means the number recorded in the balance sheet is based on the historical market interest rates and it's not necessarily updated to reflect changes in the market. Since it's less complex and time-consuming, it's the most common approach used by companies. However, they can also choose to use the fair value approach, which measures the debt at its fair value each period, and the financial statements are prepared and updated regularly using the current market interest rates. While this may be a more accurate reflection of the debt value, it can be more time-consuming and costly for companies to employ. Now that we've cleared that up, let's talk about the specific options a company has when they're looking to access long-term debt. Let's say we have a company that's looking to purchase a new office building, but they don't have enough cash. What can they do? There's two primary sources for obtaining long-term debt financing. One, they can borrow from a financial institution, or two, they can issue bonds in the capital markets. If the company chooses option number one, they could enter into a legal contractual agreement with a bank or other lending institution where they would sign a promissory note or notes payable. the value of the loan amount would be reported under the liabilities section on the balance sheet. In this case, they would be committing to pay the principal balance of the loan back at a future date with additional interest along the way. In order to obtain this type of financing, the company would have to have enough collateral to secure the financing through either the assets they own or through the value of the new building they're purchasing. What this means is that if they fail to pay back the loan, the bank would have the right to seize the new building and sell it to recover the funds. So what if the company's loan application gets denied because they don't have strong enough financial help? Or what if the company isn't actually interested in taking out a traditional loan, but still needs long-term financing to buy the building? In that case, they could go with option number two, which would be to issue bonds in the capital markets. A bond is a financial contract, which is similar to the agreement we just discussed with the bank. However, in this case, instead of signing a note payable, the financial contract is referred to as a bond indenture and involves many lenders instead of just that single institution. These lenders can include individual investors and companies that have agreed to purchase the bonds from the company for an agreed upon price with the intention of earning interest while they hold it. Ultimately, they'll sell the bond back at a date in the future and recover their initial investment. Since the funds that the company receives need to be paid back in the future, bonds appear on the balance sheet under the title of bonds payable. Now, whether the company decides to take on a note payable from a bank or a bond payable from investors, the amount to be paid back in future years must be reported under the category of long-term debt on the balance sheet. And that brings us to the end of this video. Now, it's clear that long-term debt markets are an excellent source of financing for companies, giving them the ability to invest in the growth of their organization. However, we need to remember that the type of debt that the company takes on can have a significant impact to both their financial reporting as well as their ability to generate future investment in the organization. While we now have a better idea how long-term debt works, if you're interested in learning more about the specific accounting treatment of both notes and bonds payable, please feel free to check out our additional videos on these topics.